So keeping the language and then adding, not eliminating those organizations that are providing basic life assistance at a below market value. I think I would like to see that as baseline, and adding organizations, and I don't know how we quantify, but maybe this isn't, organizations seeking funding, property, or permitting, not on its own behalf. I'd like to see something like that included. I also like the idea of, I think including, making sure that we do include that any for-profit that would establish a 501c3 arm would not be part of this exemption. And then also figuring out what the budget size cap is, whether that's, I saw multiple times, the 2.5 million, less than, any organization that falls less than a 2.5 million in gross receipts, or maybe we look at staff, so maybe organizations that have less than, and again, this is sort of arbitrary, but like 10, so semi-arbitrary, you know, working in a nonprofit, I know that all of the hats that I wear and all of the things that I'm doing, and our organization is national, and we have 75 employees. Our budget, our annual operating budget is above 2.5 million, so we wouldn't fall. But thinking about like what's the point when an organization does have access to greater resources like in-house counsel or something along those lines, those things specifically would make me feel a lot more comfortable.
I completely agree, especially with regards to the cap. There was one of the, it's Mr. Sutton, but mentioned the 2 million cap, the 2.5. Commissioner Overseen mentioned 2.5. And I know it's tricky with regards to the size of staff, because again, the nonprofit that I belong to, we were lawyers, and so we do a lot of our stuff. And I mean, you know, we have an outside CPA, but as far as like a lot of the everyday tasks, we use our resources inside the organization. But I would be interested in exploring the cap and also the additional language with regards to not only the basic life assistance, but also people lobbying. Commissioner Overseen put it more articulately than I did. It
took me a really long time to get there, so.
Thank you.
So, did you almost throw something at me? I don't know what's happening over there. Okay.
People are getting punchy.
All right, yeah, so I think it's time. I have some legal concerns regarding treating some 501c3s as different from other 501c3s. So I, from a policy perspective, do not disagree necessarily with what I've heard, but I will say I am concerned about, so it's one thing to treat all 501c3s one way, and it's one, because we already treat them differently from for-profits and 501c4s, but to start really chopping up some 501c3s from others makes me anxious. And not because I don't think that there are really good reasons, but because I don't want to open up the city to liability. In addition, I think that we need to be careful about too many kind of distinctions between, I think we need to be careful about too many distinctions. I think we're all trying to get to the same place, which is that we don't want to regulate anybody who's helping people eat or get housing or live or get medical care or whatever it is. We don't want to burden them, and we don't want them to have to stop doing what they're doing. But I don't want to get into a situation where we're just chopping this up too much, and I didn't mean for that to sound targeted to any comments that were just had. It's just been festering for me. So perhaps we can come back on the or on the nonprofit exemption. Let's see, I mean, does this sound right to people? Perhaps we can come back on this with the hope that it look, that we'd be very circumspect about treating some 501c3s as different from others. And with the understanding that I think definitions like, so if a 501c3 is formed by a for-profit, I think it's still, what you're trying to get at is this funnel, the possible funnel. Mm-hmm. So the for-profit is basically gets this windfall because it's a 501c3. But I wonder if that's, if you're a bona fide 501c3, it doesn't matter who ultimately formed you. So let's say Google says we want to form a 501c3 because we really care about all the homeless people who all our employees are seeing on the way to the office. It seems to me that they have to legally be a separate entity. So is that, maybe you could, I understand Vice President Overstein's concerns. Maybe you could come tell us, you know, how much are they actually prevented from acting like a funnel, which is, I think, your concern. And then,
yeah, I mean, to that point, so an organization that's formed by the members of a community where their genuine well-being, and again, it's not for profit, but it's, you know, it's better life environment. When Google or Disney is forming a 501c3 to be charitable and giving, does seem to have, there's a different intended outcome and different capacity behind that outcome.
Okay, so maybe we can have a clarification on that matter. This issue of kind of on its own behalf, what concerns me about that is that, so let's say it's public counsel on its own behalf. Well, what public counsel does is provide legal services. So whether they be advocating for their organization and or whether they be advocating in terms of providing direct services, it seems to me it's either directly or indirectly trying to get at their mission. So perhaps we can have kind of narrow clarification on whether what that exactly would look like. And I will also say, we heard some public comment about mission-driven. It seems to me that every nonprofit is mission-driven. It's just that some of them were really, really concerned that these registration requirements are literally going to mean that somebody doesn't meet because resources are going to somebody else. So it seems like there is a desire for more information. I would say let's try and keep that as kind of finite as to your concerns as possible. And with the understanding that I think we're never gonna hit exactly what we want. An exemption will not get exactly what we want. And we're just trying to get closer to that imperfect
line. And I think that the difficulty is exacerbated by the fact that there are different purposes that we're trying to get at. I think some of it is not to use up resources that are so limited, we're so small. So that's one of the things that when Liberty Hill brings up the IRS, they say, well, just kick out those that don't have gross receipts of 2.5 million or some other figure. And that takes care of not taking resources away from where it's needed. And then some of the other is just the fear of the chilling effect of becoming enough a part of the system that the good volunteers or good people will say, no, I don't want to do it. I'm afraid I might be opening myself up for liability. And so we have to one, deal with the resource issue, which maybe we need to have more hypotheticals and a more explanation of what these things really cost to do and what they mean. And then on the rung, the prong that it talks about chilling effect, and I think if we don't have the pipe of the public right of action, I heard that linked at least 3 or 4 times with the chilling effect and how if we don't have that, dealing with the chilling effect might be a lot easier. And just still, again, coming with a hypothetical, how it would be chilling to, one, be registered, and two, to log those contacts. I mean, a lot of people are not going to be spending 65 hours in private meetings. I just don't see that in today's world. I wish they were, a lot of them. And if they were, I would think they would be using it as a fundraising tool as well. And I certainly get a lot of those.
I could interrupt with some unfortunate news. We just learned that the City Council has scheduled a committee meeting for this room at 2 o'clock. So we are down to the wire.
Is it unfortunate?
It was.
Unfortunate. So, all right, so let's. So we have 8 minutes. That, Commissioner Orton, I love the idea of hypotheticals. It's extremely helpful. Is there a general consensus on the 501c3 exemption that we may be comfortable with something close to what we're looking at, with the understanding that we are going to do further investigation just into the issue of the cap, the for-profit funding, and on the own, its own behalf, but that we don't plan on, and please correct me if I'm wrong, we don't plan on reopening more than that, that we're narrowing in, we're getting closer, and those questions will answer for us where we're going, with understanding that the staff and the community know we don't want to look at all or nothing again. We're just kind of inching at the margin.
Yeah.
Okay. The direct communications, my sense is that we should do the same thing, that, well, I mean, are there 3 votes to approve the current proposal?
There's one.
I'm okay. Okay. All right, so we can approve the direct communications. Okay, so I would make a motion that we approve the proposal of reporting period. We approve the proposal that we have made this meeting of a reporting period every 2 months, a filing deadline 20 days later. We approve because we have at least 3 votes for the direct communications. We table with narrow instructions for further feedback on the 501c3 exemption. And we approve our proposal that we not approve the proposal of the private attorney general. I used to bill by the hour for saying things like that. Does that sound reasonable?
And just for clarification purposes, the remaining bulk of the proposed language in attachment F would be approved as part of this?
I think we are comfortable with everything we did not discuss today. Or I am comfortable with that. My discomfort was based on the things we discussed today. All right, so given what I have laid out, I think maybe somebody else should to propose that.
Since I was the troublemaker,
I was joining in.
For consensus purposes, I move that the commission approve the reporting period as amended to recommend it every 2 months, bi-monthly, and with the recommendation of 20 days for the filing deadline. That the commission approve the direct communications ordinance as written.
I thought we were amending official title only report as at only
I hadn't gotten there yet, we haven't talked about it.
I think we weren't there. I'm sorry, I think we weren't there on the bifurcated proposal.
We can certainly come back and discuss that in more detail. There actually is some language in the governmental ethics ordinance that identifies specific positions in the city that are considered high-level officials. And so that might be a place to start.
If you can come back on discussion of that and maybe date, because we didn't talk about that, then I think we have unanimous approval for everything. Because we have.
And we are having further discussion on the 501(c)(3) exemption to include the areas that Commissioner President Levinson has discussed. And that we agreed not to approve the private attorney general provision.
I will second that motion, and I apologize. I thought we weren't going to be able to get to a unanimous place. All those in favor?
Aye.
All right. Thank
Sorry,
you.
Chair, can you repeat what the final was on the contacts?
We will be coming back on the issue of direct contacts. Because we're all getting younger, on the issue of exactly who, so the your kind of bifurcated proposal and the issue of dates.
Oh, so talking back.
And that's it, and nothing outside of that. Thank you. Yeah, and the 501(c)(3), obviously. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.